Good morning, Grant Shapps. Thanks for joining us. The government has obviously made these changes. Will you be going on holiday this summer? Are you now telling Brits we're moving out of this lockdown and encouraging Brits to go abroad?
Like I was going to say, like most of the country, I've been waiting for our own announcement in order to decide whether we're going to try and go away this summer or not. And I don't get that information until the Joint Biosecurity Centre present their latest data, which they did yesterday, and we announced it the same day. So I suspect it will be a subject of conversation in the Shapps household this weekend, but we haven't made any plans as yet.
You don't want to end up what happened last year, wasn't it? Were you in Spain? You had to flee home before before you had to quarantine.
I actually went to Spain having an idea that that was going to happen, but felt that I could not and should not act on that information. And so I went along and then, as you say, sent myself home to start my quarantine. The good news is this year that, and so much as we've learned so much over the last year, we now have three weekly reviews rather than weekly reviews, which doesn't mean people can get off and not be looking over their shoulders and enjoy the August holiday. And also, of course, the vaccination program, which makes a massive difference and is the thing which creates a wall of defense for us. So I hope people can go off and enjoy their breaks. It's certainly well earned this last year.
Can I just pick up on the very small point that you just said there? Obviously, three-week reviews, we're not looking at the end of August. So are you saying that irrespective of what may happen in any of these countries that have been moved to green or to amber, that that will not change? The rules will not change until that next review.
Yeah, I mean, that's certainly our intention. No one can ever say never with the coronavirus, as we all know. But our firm intention is to leave the traffic lights as they are for 3 weeks, let people get off and come back, and then we'll review where countries fit into the system. So that's the intention. You know, coronavirus, as we know, can be an unpredictable beast, but we hope that people can just enjoy the holidays and not have to spend their time on Twitter or elsewhere looking at weekly announcements, because we don't intend to be making them.
The criteria for which countries move where seem quite arbitrary. India has moved into the amber list, and official figures show cases there are rising. We know that the India Delta variant was responsible for a spike in cases here in the UK. I mean, do you even know the criteria for which countries are moving on to which list? Because it does often feel like the government just makes it up as it goes along.
Well, fortunately, that's not the case. And actually, anybody can look up the criteria. It's published on gov.uk, and the Joint Biosecurity Centre, that's the group of experts who provide this advice, actually show their methodology, which is essentially a combination of the level of the prevalence of the virus in any given place. And in India, since you mentioned it, their prevalence is much lower than the UK right now. The amount of people who've been vaccinated, the progress of a vaccination programme, the amount of data which is publicly and properly available. So there are international standards for the data. There's a site called GizAid that countries should upload to, but many don't. And then also the extent to which they genome sequence the virus where there are positive cases. So that tells you about variants. And not all countries do that at a great level. So those are the main factors. There are then subdivisions below them. But people can go to the Joint Biosecurity website and see exactly the methodology. And that's what's enabled them in this case to take India, one of the first countries on the red list, off the red list now, because their cases have fallen very much lower, in fact, lower than ours.
You've talked, haven't you, about obviously these countries moving on to the red list. Mexico's most notably among them. I think you were suggesting this morning there may be 6,000, is it? Certainly thousands and thousands of Brits currently in Mexico who'll have to get back before Sunday in order to avoid quarantine, and yet you've jacked up the prices substantially for those people staying in hotels that, frankly, listening to people who stayed in them, aren't terribly nice. Bad conditions, rats, food not delivered on time. How can you justify whacking up the price that much, essentially, for people who can frankly afford it, but for many people who cannot?
Yes. Yeah, so first of all, we don't want people traveling to red list countries, and people can't come here unless they're British or Irish citizens or have permanent residence in the UK from red list countries. Obviously, where a country changes, and you give Mexico as an example, and as you rightly say, we think there are probably 5,000 or 6,000 Brits who are or were in Mexico who will be now trying to come back. When people return and they're asked to quarantine, we don't want that to be at taxpayers' expense. Remember, we're encouraging people not to travel on the red list. And at the moment, the system has required about £75 million of taxpayers' money to keep it going. We need it to pay for itself. In terms of the hotels, these are not, although it's government quarantine, we're not sending people to barracks. We're not, this is not sort of, these are hotels that people would normally pay for holidays in or to transit through. Many of them are very high-end hotels, as it happens. Where there are reports of problems, I know the Department of Health, who runs this managed quarantine system, will absolutely be following through on them, because that is completely unacceptable, actually in exactly the same way as it would be if it was a holidaymaker in those hotels. That's not the standard of accommodation that we would ever put up with in this country, and it certainly shouldn't be the case, as you say, for people returning on the red list. I know they'll be investigating.
And can I just move you on a little bit to the announcement the government made yesterday that they would be accepting the JCVI, Joint Committee on Vaccinations and Immunisations, advice to offer sort of blanket vaccines for 16 and 17-year-olds, healthy 16 and 17-year-old. 2 weeks ago, they'd provided the government evidence saying that they'd looked at all the evidence and that there was minimal health benefits to offering the jab, and that they did not recommend that because the benefits did not outweigh the risks. They've now said the government should go ahead and offer those jabs. Mm-hmm. What advice has actually changed? What's changed in those 2 weeks that now the government will go ahead and offer jabs to children?
Yes, the government, I should say, does whatever the JCVI, the Joint Committee on Vaccines and Immunisation, says. What most people don't realise is they are what's known as a statutory authority. So we are required to follow their advice. They are the experts, after all, medically. I think what's happened in that intervening period is they've carried on their research and come to the conclusion, looking at global evidence on this, because other countries have been vaccinating young people, that for the time being, they're comfortable with 16 and 17-year-olds, particularly with the first vaccination. And then they're going to explain how they want to roll out the time gap, etc., for the second. And presumably, they'll also carry on looking at the younger age groups down to 12 as well. They are very cautious. I'm a parent. People, you know, listening to this, may be worried about their children.
Will you be jabbing your kids?
Yes, definitely have them vaccinated. Yeah. But part of my confidence in that is knowing that the JCVI are being so cautious with it, that if they say it's okay and they're on the cautious side of this, then it's okay to do. And not only that, important to do both for them and for the wider benefits as well. I think their cautiousness should give people reason to be very confident in their decision making.
And just very finally, Transport Secretary, before you let you go, I'm going to ask a rather selfish question or a self-interested question, if I can. And that is about it coming back to travel and countries, particularly in Europe, recognising the NHS app when you've been double jabbed. So, for example, I'm going to Belgium next week because I have to pick up my stuff. It's still in a flat over there. But Belgium doesn't recognise at the moment the NHS app. I'm double jabbed, so it makes no difference. And there are many countries across Europe that, frankly, don't recognise whether you're double jabbed if you've been double jabbed in this country under the NHS rules. Are you talking to transport ministers? I mean, is this likely to change? Because frankly, if it doesn't, there's no point in going to countries, even if you double jab, because you'll still have to quarantine. Not much of a holiday to quarantine when you get
no,
there.
No, quite. No, absolutely, we are talking. I am talking to my opposite numbers. I was with my French opposite number, Jean-Baptiste Bagé, week before last, actually at Dover, looking at the way that the French Border Force equivalent are recognising the NHS app for people crossing, because we have juxtaposed their border is on our side of the channel. And we were looking at the way they're using that. And we, of course, want to both recognise the European system and have them recognise our system. And actually, by and large, that is exactly what's happening. I will follow up on your Belgium example, because I don't think there's any reason for countries not to recognise our NHS app. And the norm is becoming for them to recognise it. France is leading the way with that. I know Germany recognises it, I believe. And I'll check into the Belgium situation.
Well, much appreciated. Transport Secretary Welchams, thank you very much indeed for joining us this morning. Thank you.
Welcome to the GB News YouTube channel. You can watch us live 24 hours a day, catch up on your favourite shows, and join in the conversation in the comments below.
Don't forget to subscribe and you'll never miss any of our exclusive content.